I'm Joy Morris, inviting you to listen to True Stories of the Wild West, hosted by C.R. King, a production of RK Enterprises.
Hello, everyone. C.R. King here. Welcome to True Stories of the Wild West. Today, my story is about who killed Gus Bobbitt. Gus Bobbitt was a good man. He was a former U.S. Deputy Marshal. And he was tough. He was hard on criminals. After a time, he married, quit his job as a lawman, picked up the plow, became a gentleman rancher, farmer. He was a member of the Masons and a churchgoer, and he loved his children and his wife. For a time, in the town named Corner, which is located above Ada, Oklahoma, Gus had part ownership with Bill Connor in the Corner Saloon. I know, that's a tongue twister. The town was a whiskey town. It was wide open. Many men met their fate at the Corner Saloon. The Corner Township was named such for its location, for it was at the extreme southeastern part of the Potawatomi County and bordered on the Seminole and Chickasaw Nations. Jesse West was a farmer, Jim Allen, a cattle rancher, and they were in partnership. West owned interest in other saloons in the general area of this whiskey town of Connor, in which many felt was the wildest town in that location of Violet Springs. Violet Springs was located roughly 3 miles north of Corner. The two men were violent, they were mean, and they wanted to control that part of the country. Shooting someone or running a person out of business was not beyond their scope. They were known or suspected for cattle rustling. Once considered friends, Gus Bobbitt, as a deputy marshal, stopped these two from taking over the country. With the backing and the help of merchants of the town of Ada, in general, they all helped him to team against West and Allen, who had no other choice but to pick up and move out of that part of the country. They moved to Canadian, Texas, located in the Panhandle, but not before Gus had accused them of stealing cattle. This was something that they never sat well with. Okay, nothing came out of the cattle rustling charge, so they were free to go. But Jesse West and Joe Allen had extreme views. They hated Gus Bobbitt, and they wanted him dead. The move to the Panhandle was in 1903. In late 1908, they found someone to kill Gus Bobbitt. Jim Miller and his partner, Barry Burrell, took 2 months to plan and execute the assassination of the former deputy marshal. On February 29th, Gus and his hired hand, Bob Figgerson, were in town loading up their wagons with supplies and headed home. Gus had the front wagon, Bob was behind him. And unbeknownst to them, a ways back, in a buggy, was Purnell, keeping tabs on their movement. Miller had been notified by Purnell as to their action in town. He was somewhere along the road, waiting, just waiting for Gus Bobbitt to show up. Now, Bowman, by the end of his career, had defended 343 murderers of which 303 were set free. None of his murderers were ever executed. He specialized in murder, defending murderers, and he was the best of lawyers when it came to helping out his clients. Now, the people of Ada, as well as all of Oklahoma at that time, was very well aware of this man's reputation. They knew that he would most likely get these guys off for having murdered the former marshal and their friend. Things happened. Now, Gus was murdered on February 27th, 1909. That was 7 weeks after the killing, and all the men involved were in jail. Miller knew that the powerful lawyer would get him off, and he was confident that soon he and his partner, the businessman negotiations with his clients to assassinate others, would be released. The town folk were also sure that they would be released because of how much of a reputation that Pew had at that time. So on April 19th, at approximately 2:10 in the morning, two men snuck into a power company and shut down the town's streetlights. Ada was pitch black. Somewhere up to 50 men, heavily armed, snuck into the city hall. They silently moved down the darkened hallways towards the back of the building where the jail was located. Four men, Jim Miller, Barry Burrell, Jesse West, and Joe Allen. They were taken to an abandoned livery stable, not 30 feet from the jail. It was now 3 a.m. Slip knots were fashioned. Miller asked to wear his hat, and they said yes. It was reported that Jim Miller, who was the first to be lynched, said to his captors, "Let her rip," and he stepped off the box voluntarily. The other men begged for their lives. It didn't work. One by one, they were hung. These men strangled to death. They hung for minutes, twisting and gasping for breath, before their efforts failed. It wasn't until 7 a.m. when these men, still hanging from the rafters of the stable, were cut down. Killing Jim Miller, a professional assassin, was dead. No one was ever arrested. No one ever knew who did what. To this day, the people who lynched them are unknown. Now, it's said that killing Jim Miller, his first nickname was Deacon Jim Miller because of the way he dressed, killed somewhere between 40 to 50 men. Of course, all for money. And while he was doing this, there was a time when he was a Texas Ranger. They knew he was an assassin. He advertised in the newspaper in Fort Worth, where he lived, his job and his willingness to kill. Well, on February 27th, 1909, Deacon Jim Miller died, as his victims did, without mercy. That's the end of my broadcast. Before I go, books by C.R. King, The Last Deputy, A Fraternity of Gunslingers, True Stories of the Wild West Gunmen, 2 volumes. Check them out. Good night, everybody. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. There's more coming. Sometimes they're even more exciting. So, take care. See you.
Stay tuned for next week's tale.